And of course, Mr. Harman said, though the government spent 200 million and more, or though about 200 million and more of taxpayers' money were used, they were not a set of hundreds of millions that came from donations. So we are not sure who donated, how much they donated, what they got in return for those donations, because they are saying that people who donate to their party and people who donate to the government, those people make a political investment and they must be rewarded. Mr. Ramjetan said so and Mr. Trotman said so. These fellows are making some of the most weird and bizarre pronouncements I've ever heard in my entire life. So we are still to ascertain how much money was actually spent on that event at the stadium, the inauguration ceremony. So that's scandal number two. Scandal number three was the cleaning up of Georgetown. You would recall that hundreds of millions of dollars were spent to clean up Georgetown. Up to now, we don't know how much money was spent. Not a single contract went to public tender. Not a single contract. Every contract that was awarded, and hundreds must have been awarded, every contract was given to a hand-picked crony contractor of theirs, including Brian Tiwari. So with the cleanup fiasco of the city of Georgetown, we are still to know how many millions have been expended. That is scandal number three. Scandal number four has to do with the Durban Park. Now, Durban Park is the place that they prepared, they built. They built a stadium, they cleared the land, they sand-filled the land, and we are told that somewhere in the vicinity of $2 billion was spent for the preparation, the construction, and the building of Durban Park, just for, to hold the 50th Jubilee celebration. Over $2 billion was expended to hold a party for our 50th birthday as a nation. And not a single contract, again, not a single contract for the works done at that project or on that project went to public procurement. So that is scandal number four. Scandal number five has to do with the president's insistence on pardoning convicted criminals without disclosing to the nation how he's arriving at these names of the persons, how he's choosing these persons, what offenses they have been convicted for how long have they been in prison, how much longer do they have to complete their sentences. None of these questions we know. All we know is that the president at periodic intervals grants pardons to dozens of convicted felons. We were told by the president himself that he will only release persons who are young and who have committed non-violent offenses. Well, we discovered that the president was not being truthful, because right here in Burbies, in Rose Hall, a man was apprehended for committing a violent robbery, and it was discovered that that man was among the persons pardoned by the president. And when an examination was done of his antecedents and the offense for which he received, he was serving a sentence for which he received a pardon from the president, that offense was robbery with violence. We are told that many of the persons who have been pardoned by the president without any process, without any principle, without any explanation, many of them are back in the prisons. So that is scandal number 6. Scandal number 7 has to do with the bond, the health facility bond, or rather the storage bond rented by the Minister of Health. $12.5 million paid in rent for 1 month. A bond is being rented. It's an old house on Sussex Street. The minister said to the house that the medicine are already there, the pharmaceutical are already there, that this bond meets international standards. The minister said that to us in Parliament on the 8th of August, earlier this month. Before the parliamentary session was completed, the press went and visited the very bond. It's an old house and they found carpenters working in the house. So the bond was not even built, but this government signed a 3-year contract to rent that bond for $12.5 million per month. Two-month security deposit was paid to the tune of $25 million. And that is the exact purchase price that the bond was recently, the property was recently purchased for by the landlord. And of course, the landlord is a crony of theirs. The landlord said, operates out of a building owned by Cathy Hughes, the executive member of the AFC and the Minister of Telecommunication. When this disclosure was made public, and we questioned the minister in the parliament, he disclosed to us that the cabinet approved the deal. That the deal was discussed at cabinet. So it's not the minister's fault. It is the fault of the entire cabinet. And this cabinet of very intelligent people decide that they will deal with the public criticism by establishing a subcommittee of cabinet to investigate a decision of cabinet. So this intelligent motley crew of ministers decide that they will form a group among themselves to investigate themselves. And they are coming up with one ridiculous and preposterous excuse after another in their attempt to justify this act of great corruption. Because this is what this is. Corruption. People are getting severe kickbacks. Ministers of the government are getting a piece of this rent. And Nagamutu, Harman and Trotman, three trained lawyers, are telling the nation that it was necessary to rent this bond because of a fire. Because the government bond is located at Diamond, just about 4 miles away. And you know, you may have traffic jams and you may have a fire and that will prevent drugs from reaching the hospital in time. What nonsense! The hospital has a bond that has the capacity to store pharmaceuticals that will last the hospital for several days. I mean, if these people are stupid, they can't expect the nation to be as stupid as them. If you want to come up with an explanation, come up with an explanation that is slightly intelligent that at least the ordinary man in the street will find somehow attractive. You cannot manufacture such mediocrity and impose that upon a nation as an excuse that you frighten that there will be a fire somewhere, that a bond will catch a fire, as though the one at Hatfield Street that they have rented is somehow fireproof. The distance between the government bond and the Hatfield Street bond, the Sussex Street bond, sorry, is just about 4 miles. So I don't know what major traffic jam there can be that will prevent drugs reaching the hospitals in time. Granted, Sussex Street is close to Georgetown Hospital, but Diamond is also close to Diamond Hospital. So you have advantages and disadvantages. But in any event, every hospital has a bond facility in the hospital compound that has the capacity of storing enough drugs to last for a couple days. So that excuse is stupid, as those who have manufactured it. So that is scandal number six. Scandal number seven is the settlement with DDL. And I have written and I have spoken about that, where billions of dollars, taxpayers' dollars, have been written off in favor of DDL. That is scandal number seven. Scandal number eight is another multi-billion settlement with BK International. Well, this one here has so many dimensions that it is not funny. We were first told that BK International breached its contract with the government. Minister Patterson and Minister Bulkan went on the television and they went in the newspapers and they reported to the nation the terrible job that BK International did at the Hackbosh dump site. That he did substantial work, that he breached his contractual obligation, and that he exposed the people in that locality to extreme dangers and public health hazards. This is what they said to the nation. BK International writes one letter. First of all, they said that the man sued them for $10 million. They said that he sued them for $10 million and they managed to settle for $5.7 million. So I went into the court system to look for this file because I want to see what exactly this man is claiming against them, or this contractor is claiming against the government. So I went into the file, into the court system, and I searched for the entire 2015 and the entire 2016, and I can't find this litigation that they're speaking about. And they have been dodging the press, refusing to answer questions regarding this litigation that they lied to the nation about. Lo and behold, today in the Kaicho News, Bulkan discloses that BK International wrote them a letter threatening to sue for $10 million. Just a letter, just a legal letter threatening to sue for $10 million, and they settled for $5.7 million. Well, comrades and friends, if any one of you have any difficulty with this government, please come to me and let us write some legal letters. And if we get $1 million per letter, I think that we will be doing very, very well. So I'm asking all of you, if you have legal problems, come to me and let us send out about 1,000 letters. And we will have, you're not going to ask for 10 million US. We're going to ask for 1 million Ghana dollars. And let us see whether the government would pay us. As they have paid their crony, BK International. But again, of course it's not BK International getting all this money. The money has to be divided. I am told three ministers have received huge portions of money. One of them made a big fight because he wasn't getting anything. And he eventually got 100,000 US or 20 million Guyana dollars. So that is scandal number 8. Scandal number 9 is the payment of the Rudisa judgment. Remember, I said in this program that first of all, they made us lose that case because they refused to pass the amendments in the parliament. And the court, the CCJ, granted judgment. But Rhodesia owes us billions and billions of dollars in taxes if we are to assess them. And we told this government, do not pay the judgment. Do not pay $1.2 billion to Rhodesia. Instead, assess them for the taxes that they owe and do a set-off arrangement. And they will still end up owing us at the end. The government disregarded our advice and doled out another $1.2 billion to this company unnecessarily. Again, I say, it's not the company getting all the money. They kick back. They kick back. These people, I don't know who have taken over this country. But the corruption is unimaginable. Unimaginable. I have real estate agents coming to tell me that they are renting properties to this government. And this government is asking the landlord to enter into two contracts. One, let us say if the landlord wants 4,000 US for a property, the ministers are asking that the contract be signed for 8,000 US and 4,000 they will collect every month on the side. That is the level of racketeering that taking place under this administration. And these people were accusing the PPP of corruption. And you, the Barbadians, you believe them. Well, look at what is going on now. If you think corruption existed under the PPP, well, I don't know what you will say in relation to what is going on now. So those are about 9 scandals, and I'm sure there are many more. Those are about 9 major scandals that have taken place over the last few months. Of course, we have the Soku. Up to now, we don't know about this Soku business, on what basis Soku running into people's homes, seizing their cash, taking away their financial records, seizing their jewelry at the airport. Who does Soku answer to? We know that it is located in the office of the president. We know that it is funded from the office of the president budget. And we therefore can infer quite reasonably that it is receiving political directions. And this is a law enforcement agency. So that's another scandal by itself. And then we have another scandal that's brewing, SARA. And tomorrow I'll be speaking at the Sleeping International Hotel on Brigdam, Georgetown, on this SARA bill. I mean, I know that you would not be there, but I'm hoping that it will be shown on the television or at least covered in the press, so that you can get an idea of what this bill is about. It is a most draconian piece of legislation that will be enacted by this government intended to seize people's property. You will hear more about it later on. So I have just dealt superficially with about 10 major scandals, and this government has only been in office for 15 months. They have had almost one scandal every month and a half. Every month and a half they have had a scandal, because I've listed 10. And if we go by that number alone, we are talking about one scandal every month and a half, because they have been in office for 15 months. But there are more scandals. They may have escaped me. I want to make some remarks about, I see the president has said that we must not have vigilante justice in the country, and that people, you know, must obey the law and must not beat bandits. Well, I cannot fault the president, quite frankly. The president is right in law, and the president is right in principle. But one has to look at the situation which the country faces. And one also has to view the president's position on the question of crime. What is the president's position on the question of crime? I don't hear the president condemning regularly the crime rate. I don't see the president speaking on behalf of the victims of crime. I don't hear the president speaking about the welfare of the families that are perishing because their loved ones, who were breadwinners of their family, were killed brutally by bandits. I don't see the president extending a hand to those people. What I see the president doing, though, with alarming frequency and with, I dare say, great emphasis, pardoning criminals. He is pardoning criminals. When the Camp Street was on fire, that was a major event. They had a commission of inquiry. I'm speaking about the Camp Street jail. So the welfare of the prisoner and the criminal is important. And of course it is. But you have to have a balance. And I am saying that the president has a bias and not a balance. Fourthly, the president speaks for the welfare of the criminals when they are beaten, arrested, and brutalized by the citizenry. But the president at the same time does not speak to the victims of crime. He does not speak or try to address the welfare of the victims of crime. The other matter that I want to speak about is that I saw the president earlier this week, or last week, Friday, inaugurating a huge murti, a Hanuman murti, at Blairmont Mandir in Region 5. And the president used that occasion to speak about social cohesion and how important social cohesion is to the development of this country. I presume that he was speaking to a gathering of Blairmont residents. But the president may not know that those persons to whom he was speaking their children and the children who may have been there listening to the president. Those children stand on the road every morning and the bus with the president's face on it that picks up school children every morning passes those very children standing on Blairmont Road and goes all the way to Ithaca to pick up children at Ithaca. In fact, the bus starts from somewhere at Belladrum and stops at selective villages, picks up children, does not stop at Bushlot, but stops at Hope Town, does not stop at Bad Settlement, does not stop at Cotton Tree, does not stop at the Edward, does not stop at Rosicklow, does not stop at Blairmont, but drives all the way to the other village and picks up children there at Ithaca and passes back and pass all those children from Blairmont standing again on the road. And the president goes to that very village and speaks about social cohesion. Well, talk is cheap. You cannot divide by your actions, and you want to cohese with words. Action speaks louder than words. So turning up to inaugurate a murti of Hanuman Swami is a good thing. And using the occasion to speak about social cohesion is a good thing. But make sure that your language is supportive or is supported by your actions. You cannot pay lip service to the concept of social cohesion, but your actions and your policies and your government's actions and your government policies are divisive and discriminatory. It will not happen. The cohesion that you want will not take place. And that is what the children of Blairmont understand. So, I thought that I'll mention those important issues as we progress with our program. Of course, the lines here have been going non-stop since I started, and I guess it's about time that I spend some more time on the phone and I talk less. So let me hear from you now. I'll begin taking phone calls. Well, we just missed that caller. And I want to take this opportunity to remind all of you, please get a copy of the Mirror newspaper every weekend. It is printed once a week. It's a new and improved newspaper. It has a lot of information. I write an article every single week. You will hear Comrade Bharat speak in that newspaper. The General Secretary also has articles in the newspaper. The former President has articles in the newspaper. And many other party leaders. Caller, you are on the air. Caller, you're on the air. Sorry, I missed that caller. So please, get a copy of your Mirror newspaper. Call your near.
Hey, good night, Vishwanath.
Hi, where are you calling me from?
East Kanji.
East Kanji?
Yes.
Yes.
I'm concerning a visit to Blairmont by the president, right?
Yes.
Is not the president go by himself? The people let me invite him. I was talking about the same thing.
Okay.
The bus transportation and...
Okay. No, nothing wrong. I don't have a problem with if the people invite the president to go. I mean, he is the president of the country. But when he goes there, they should have used the opportunity. When he speaks about social cohesion, maybe they did tell him that their children are left on the road while the David Granger bus number 1 and 2 passes past them and go to Ithaca to pick up children.
Yeah, but you see, we gotta blame our people, ourselves, the gambling, nobody else.
Well, I don't want to stop anyone from inviting anybody to their place. They are free to do so. But, you know, we must be able to speak up for our rights. We must be able to condemn wrongs. Discrimination is a wrong. And the right to be protected against discrimination is a constitutional right which we must assert and defend. All right, caller, thank you very much. So that caller has the same concerns that here it is, the Mandir invites the president, but the Mandir is, I don't know whether the Mandir is unconcerned, but the children are left on the road by the bus. Caller, you're on the air.
Hello, Mr. Good night.
Yeah, I'm not hearing you. You have to speak up.
Hello, Mr. Good night.
Good night.
I'm a Kwajam Village.
Where you calling him from?
Kwajam Village.
Where?
47 Village.
47?
Yeah.
Hi, Ramjetan Village.
I live in the Garden School Street. And I see BK and Kokabak staying there for 4 months now. And nobody pays his way.
But this is the village of Kemraj Ramjetan.
Yeah.
Have you called Mr. Ramjetan?
No, I don't know.
Huh?
I don't have his number.
Go and collect his number from his mother.
For 5 months or 6 days.
All right, could you draw on a... I was joking with you. Could you go to the NDC office and lodge a complaint?
I lodge some complaint.
All right, well, I know that the regional administration officials, I know that they normally look at this program, so I am hoping that they are taking note. It is a street in 47 Village?
The Kindergarten School Street.
The Kindergarten School Street. Thank you very much, caller. So if the regional officials are listening to me, if the NDC officials are listening to me, this resident of 47 Village is complaining about the state of the street where the Kindergarten School is located in that village. So please look into the matter for me. Caller, you're on the air.
Good night, Mr. Nanda.
Good night. Where are you calling me from?
Albion. I just saw the news in Channel 12 that we'll have a next budget on the 6th of December. This year we passed the biggest budget. The government go back into Parliament, ask for more money, they do. And I'll pass one on the 6th of December for next year.
Yes.
So I'll be there for again.
Well, caller, thank you. This caller, you see, that's why I need to open this. I open this line. Our people are so intelligent and they are so observant. This caller has raised with me the fact that only in February of this year, we passed the biggest budget in the history of this country. And by July, the money finished. And they came back to the parliament for $3 billion more dollars. And now, we are passing another budget in December. So the money finished again in December. Well, that is what happens, caller, when one, you spend, because you didn't work for it, you don't appreciate its value, but more importantly, you do not earn. We are not earning as a country, but we are spending like multimillionaires. Caller, you're on the air.
Good night.
Good night. I have a volume problem here. Speak up, please.
Good night.
Yes.
I'm calling from Bushland.
Bushlat, West Coast or?
Oh, West Coast.
West Coast, yes.
I listened on night range in a back on TV. Sir. When them in Utah for them, so job not for young people. Then he say young people don't got create their own job. They got self employed. Then when I say about crime, when PPP in there. How them in there, what am I doing with the crime?
Well, caller, you have raised two important issues, and you would have, thank you, and you would have heard me speak about both. While they were in government, while they were in the opposition, of course they have lied to the people on so many accounts. But one of the biggest lies to young people was the promise to create jobs for young people. When they are in government, Mr. Granger says job creation is not a function of government, that you have to go and find it and create your own job. He didn't know that when he made the promise to the people of this country. As I said last week, there are billboards all around this country with the president and the prime minister's photograph, vote AP and new AFC. We promise jobs. That's what the billboard says. Today, when to deliver the job, having received the votes or stole the votes, the president says that government business is not to create jobs. Caller, you're on the air.
Hello, Daniel.
Hi.
Yeah, man. You've been watching CNN, but it's budget up from the 5th of December. They got to pass this budget. But sugar workers now get nothing.
Well, sugar workers, you know, and you know, I spoke to so many sugar workers in 2011 and in 2015. I was cursed, I was abused by so many sugar workers when I used to tell them that Nagamutu is fooling them when they were promised 25% increase in salary. And in wages, and they were promised more holidays and less working hours and all sorts of ridiculous, wild and reckless promises.
What, 2 budgets for 1 year?
Well, we're going to deal with that. And the sugar workers believed today they are reaping the bitterness of that promise, of those false promises. But, as you said, is that 2 budget? It will be almost 3 budget. Because in February they got a national budget. They spent out the money by July. They came back to the parliament in August for $3 billion more. And it looked like the money finished again. So they are coming back in December for more money.
Yeah, man.
All right, caller?
Yeah, but cover number 72 village.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Okay, good. Thank you. So that caller was from number 72 village. Caller, you're in the air.
Hello.
If you want to call in this program and you want to participate constructively, then you will be required to lower the volume of your television. Caller, you're on the air.
Hi, good night.
Good night.
How are you? I'm calling from Palmyra.
Palmyra. How are you?
I just want to inform you, and I got a pinch of Serge Bali going to leave office in December. On his own. He decided.
Well,
and,
there is a rumor circulating that he is about to leave office. So at least we have that to look forward to. That's one problem gone. Because we have to do all that is necessary to ensure that we win the next elections. Because this country is going to be destroyed. all the indications are there. The writings are on the wall. The country is heading to bankruptcy once it continues along this path of spending, and no earning. All right, caller?
Yeah, for us to win another election, we have to wipe the GCOM out from top to bottom. These presiding officers that keep employing and employing and all the time, they smart, they walk on the ground.
I know. We are at the level of the party's leadership, pursuing a number of measures designed to address those concerns. All right? So don't feel that we are not working. We are working night and day on these matters. All right, caller, thank you. So that caller has some valid concerns about GCOM. Very legitimate and very, very constructive. Caller, you're on the air.
Hello?
Yes?
Hello? Hello?
Yes?
Could you shed some light on Mr. Ramesh Charles Kolchak?
Oh, thank you. Thank you for reminding me. Mr. Van West Charles, the son-in-law of former President Forbes Burnham, I don't know where he was for about 30 years. Suddenly he comes back into this country when this government assumes office and lands a big job. Well, he's a leader of the PNC. Lands a big job with GWI as the CEO. And then forms a company or joins a company. He joins the company after the elections of 2015. And the company makes an application for 3 fuel licenses. 1 to store fuel, 2 to transport fuel, to wholesale fuel, and 3 to import fuel. This company gets all 3 of these licenses within 5 weeks. If you read one of the newspapers, I did an interview in which I pointed out that I was the legal advisor for the Guyana Energy Agency for a number of years, and that is the agency that grants these licenses. I helped to craft the law and the regulations which govern the grant of these licenses. To get one of these licenses, you have, especially like the storage license, you have to have a whole host of requirements that you have to satisfy. You have to have storage facilities. It must be located in an area that is safe because it's fuel that you're storing. You have to have fuel tanks. You have to have a whole host of devices to fight fire in the event of a combustion. You have to get an environmental permit, which will only be granted to you after an environmental impact assessment is done. You have to put an advertisement in the newspapers inviting people in your neighborhood to get their views, because if you are storing fuel near their homes, they are also at risk. Then you have to get the local authority and the regional democratic council to give you certain permissions. You have to get a fire service to come and inspect and certify your place. You have to get public health to give you certain licenses. There is no way that those requirements can ever be satisfied in 5 months. These processes take years, but it is corruption, it is nepotism. You ask the gas station owners in Barbies, ask them how long they may have applied for a fuel storage license or a fuel transportation license, and see if they got it. I know, I helped to administer the system. The system doesn't work like that. So that was a corrupt act. taking place there. Caller, you're on the air.
Hey, Mr. Nanalal, good night, sir.
Good night.
I am calling from Bachata, Manchester, Mr. Bobby.
Hi.
I always enjoy your program.
Thank you.
I have made a few observations.
Yeah.
One of them when you said spending money. Well, the old people would not use that term. They would use a stronger term. They would use the term bilawi.
Bilawi, I know.
Bilawi.
Yes.
It's a very strong Hindi term that means much more than wasteful.
Yes.
But that's a better term for you, bilawi.
Yes, well, your bilawi, that we should have worked for.
Yes.
You understand?
And that term only connects to money, not like you can say wasting water. It connects to money.
I know. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, caller. That caller has assisted me with the use of a Hindi term to describe this condominia which is taking place with taxpayers' dollars in this country. Caller, you're on the air.
Good night, sir.
Good night.
I just want to ask a question, man. Why the NDC not get pay regular every week?
What?
NDC.
Which NDC?
Other NDC.
But, comrade, how you... You ask me a question. You got to give me information. I don't understand. When you pick up your phone, you expect me to know which NDC you're talking about? So you're talking about Albion NDC. And what is the problem with Albion NDC?
November, December, I don't get paid until now yet.
You don't get paid. So I got to assume that you work at the Albion NDC.
Yes.
What work you do there, partner?
I'm a security guard.
You're what?
Security guard.
You're a security guard. Well, you're not going to tell me all that information, man. And you work where? At the NDC office itself?
Yes.
All right. Well, a lot of NDC officials are looking at this program. And I'm sure that they know who you are. And I will ask the overseer, I will ask the chairman, and I will ask the other relevant officers, the other counselors, at the Albion NDC. The security man says he has not been paid for several months. I am asking respectfully whether you can address that matter. Thank you. Caller, you're on the air. Hello?
Hey, Carl from Bushrat, West Coast.
Yes?
You see, Alan thing when a man talks about PPP, they might do 100 times worse. Then you see, maybe just like a beer camp man.
I know, caller. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you, caller. Pissing in ass, I tell you. True to that.
All right. Thank you. All right, we will take one last call, and then I'll have to bid you goodbye because the operator has signaled me already. Caller, you are on the air.
Hi, good night.
Good night.
I want to thank you that you're updating this program every week.
Thank you.
Thank you for that, but I got a problem.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Amsterdam. I want to know if the police make a parking spot, or I don't know if it is a new government buy a parking spot in Amsterdam for DSL. Imagine a car park of today, this morning.
Wait, we got to go slowly.
Okay.
You are complaining about a parking facility
at New Amsterdam.
Located in New Amsterdam. Now, New Amsterdam is a big place.
Yes.
You have to give me more information.
But I rent a GRA to pay a revenue tax.
Okay. Where is the parking facility that you're speaking about?
Next to GPMP.
Next to?
GPMP.
G?
GPMP.
PPNV?
GPMP.
I'm not hearing you.
GPMP. Opposite the station, next to the GRA.
Opposite the police station, next to the GRA.
Yes, a car was parked there. The car was pulled out where the police officer seen the car pull out and got angry. I go and park my vehicle there, like less than 20 minutes. The police come and arrest me and kill me in the station and tell me that you're going to pull me car and get me in the thing and start to be rude to me. I didn't even start to see it. He started to be rude to me and just think. Another thing, I simple asked her that why you want to pong the vehicles? I didn't get no reason. She started to molest me and start everybody and talking once as a crush. I don't know what she's talking, but she pong in the vehicle. I don't know what the reason she pong in the vehicle for.
I tried to explain that. I said that, ma'am, what you trying to pong the vehicle for? He told me that I parked double parking and the vehicle was in the car now. Now he pong the vehicle, take my insurance, take my fitness, my revenue, my license, tell me in the station and ask me how long me drive. And get in the license in our hand.
And what became of the matter? What was the eventual outcome?
I explained and tell her everything. Then she watched me and then she got me to sign on the warning book and then give me a name. I said, telling you the truth, I parked less than 50 minutes here and the next car followed. You could go and ask everybody.
So you were not charged or anything?
That's not a thing. But the arresting people very bad and don't want to listen to people.
Alright, Paula, thank you. I get a picture. Well, you see, I get complaints like this all the time. But we have to fight the system as a collective. This used to happen when we were in government as well. I don't blame the government for this. This is the police attitude, which I've always found to be offensive. The harassment of civilians, the harassment of citizens, it takes place on a regular basis. But we as citizens have to take up the mantle of fighting this thing. We have to write. People don't like to write in this country. We have to write letters to the newspapers, write to the Commissioner of Police, write to the Police Complaints Authority, write to the Commander, write to the Internal Police Disciplinary Tribunal that is inside the force. Make your complaints public and make your lodge your complaints at the appropriate offices. That's the only way that we can participate in the fight against the harassment which we claim at the hands of the police force. Now, this is where I have to say, unfortunately, goodbye. And again, I know the calls are coming in non-stop, but unfortunately, as the saying goes, every good thing comes to an end. And this program has now come to an end. And I want to take this opportunity to wish each and every one of you a pleasant rest of the evening. And to invite you once again to join me next week, Tuesday, at 7 p.m. when we will resume our weekly discussions on the matters that are important in the news. So until that time, please take care and have a blessed week. Thank you and goodbye.